The Chickasawhay River in eastern Mississippi is a very special place. Its history is read in the curves of its path through strata that once laid at the bottom of shallow seas rich with life, written in the language of the earth. The story revealed in its riverbanks is of seas rising and falling, astronomical clocks, sea creatures great and tiny, and perpetual change. It is our heritage. I'm Mark Puckett, professor of geology at the University of Southern Mississippi. We're going to take a trip down the Chickasawhay River in the southeastern part of the state and show you how it is one of the most geologically important rivers, not only in the state, but perhaps the world, and how it tells a story millions of years old. With us will be George Phillips, curator of paleontology at the Mississippi Museum of Natural Science, and James Starnes, geologist at the Mississippi Office of Geology. Join us as we go 35 million years down the Chickasawhay. Millions of years ago, when these sediments were deposited, there were a series of transgressions and regressions, that is, advances and retreats in sea level. And each time the seas advanced, they brought with them an abundance of marine life, and their remains are still here. This is one of the main reasons that geologists and other interested people have been coming to the Chickasawhay River for decades in order to collect fossils from the kinds of life forms that lived during this time period. These sediments that we'll see range from about 35 to 28 million years old. Most of the rivers in Mississippi tend to either go along one single formation or they cut across formations that don't have very many fossils. So one of the great things about this river is that as we travel downstream, we get into younger and younger sediments, and many of which are very rich in the kinds of life forms that lived at this time.
I'm starting to see a little bit of seashells already.
The blue material?
Yeah.
Boy,
gosh,
that is
beautiful, beautiful.
Man, that's nice stuff.
Just like rivers carried this sediment out to sea to make the land we're sitting on now, this river's carrying sediment out to sea to create more land in the Gulf.
Exactly right. What's interesting, too, is this was part of an inland sea during this time. This time interval is late Eocene and Oligocene. And there was a sea that covered almost all of central Mississippi called the Jackson Sea. And so places that were like in Hattiesburg and Laurel, the sediments that those cities are built on had not even been deposited yet. They will not be deposited for several more million years. The Earth's past is broken down into intervals like days are broken down into hours, hours into minutes, and minutes into seconds. As I mentioned, the layers along this river were deposited in time intervals known as the Eocene and Oligocene epochs. And because there are so many fossils here, we can tell exactly where time changed from the Eocene to the Oligocene. I tell you, one of the great things about this sediment, you notice it's this nice blue, beautiful bluish kind of green color. These kind of colors are very characteristic of marine deposits. And what's amazing too is that people have been coming here for over 100 years to collect the fossils, but these small fossils are too small to see with your naked eye. So they've been here maybe many times and never had any idea these little tiny fossils were here.
There are far more tiny fossils here than there are the big fossils, so it's an entire world down there.
But these things are actually a part of, make up a big chunk of this entire sediment here. And this particular spot, this is what's called the Shibuta clay. And geologists, paleontologists have been, as I said, coming here for a long time and then named a lot of species for the first time here. And at least the ones I study, little tiny crustaceans called ostracods, they named them here, and some of them have been found all over the world. And there's one called, a couple of them actually, there's a Barrettia hawaiianensis. Hawaii is a town that's very close by here. And there's a Crithi hawaiianensis, and these are found in the deep ocean. This is the first place they were found. Another group that is very important is called Buntonia shibutaensis. And that was the type species for this genus, Buntonia. And now Buntonia has been found all over the world. It's a very, very common genus. And this is the first time it was named here.
Now, when we find these fossils that are the same species in, say, another country or on the other side of the world, what does that say about the age? Are they, what does it say?
One of the things, if you find some that are actually found all over the world, generally that means it's gonna be planktonic. So they floated in the ocean so they can get across the world pretty easy. Now, and tell you the truth, if you look at the ones that I studied, they're little tiny crustaceans about the size of a pinhead, and they have to walk wherever they went. They're benthic organisms, so they couldn't go very far. And most of these that are here are only found in this region. And so it's a really interesting story about evolution, too. You can see how rapidly these things could evolve. They go into a new area, you find new species, they live for a little while and then became extinct.
That's incredible.
So it's real, it's quite a life story.
During the Eocene and Oligocene epochs, there were several formations that were deposited. The different layers that we'll see on our trip will go from oldest to youngest, starting with the Coco Sand and working our way up to the Mariana Limestone.
These sediments are tilted slightly to the south. You can see that really, really well at this point. If you notice this relatively hard ledge right here is about 6 feet above the water surface. If we look down, farther down there, we can see it actually is going into the water. So that makes it kind of neat as we're making our way down the Chickasawhay River, we're getting into younger and younger sediments. So they're to pile on top of each other and tilted. So even though we wind around, that's one of the great things about the Chickasawhay River, is it does go pretty much what's called down dip. In other words, the farther down we go, the younger we get. So those earliest sediments that we saw were about 35 million years old. These are slightly younger. It's the same formation, the Shibuta clay here. And we'll see lots of changes as we go down the river.
This gravel bar, you've noticed it's made up of this red rock. And this red rock is a mineral geologists know as siderite. Now siderite is formed in very, very shallow marine environments. So we know the depth of water
near the ocean when we see this. It only is formed within this very, very shallow marine environment. It's very heavy, it's red, it's irony, and it's a type of mineral we call iron carbonate or siderite.
Our planet was really much warmer than it is today. There was no ice on any of the poles, either Antarctica or the Arctic region. But starting right in here, the world was going through a major transition during this time period. The climate was changing quite a bit. The world started to cool down. And this is the first evidence of ice first building up on Antarctica. And so these sediments that we'll see from now on, the rest of the trip, are kind of in a transition time between the very warm planet that was occurred in the Eocene and the ice ages that we've in fact occurred, that have occurred over the last few million years. We can see a very definite layer right there, this mineral called siderite. It's a concretionary layer. This is actually an important boundary for several different reasons. One is that this is the boundary between the Eocene epoch below and the Oligocene epoch above. And geologists, mainly paleontologists, have been here to try to figure out exactly where that boundary is. And it just so happens it's very, very close or right at this siderite layer here. We can also see some other evidence of shallowing of the water. So like right here, there is a thin lens, and there are thin lenses also of concentrations of fossils. And it suggests that there was some kind of a current that was moving and concentrating the fossils. And especially as we move up the section, we get more and more sand. So all these are clues that sea level is changing. So this is an important point, because when geologists are looking all over the world to try to calibrate the changes in sea level and exactly where they occurred, they can come here to this point, and they did, and they have come here to look and to date this and find out, well, at this point exactly, we can see evidence of sea level drop. So they can go to other places around the world and see if they see the drop at the same point. This is one of the real values of the little tiny fossils that we see here, because they're all in the sediment, these little, the size of a pinhead, but they're all the way through here.
We found some really nice complete versions of some of the shells for which we've only found fragments earlier. In my left hand here, we've got some helmet shells, two different species, in fact. For one species, we've got an adult and juvenile of this species, the genus Galeadea. And this is a contemporary genus of a marine snail called Sconcia. So these are two helmet shells, or bonnet shells is another term for them. Here in my right hand, we have a nice chunk of colonial coral. This is the first colonial coral we've seen today. We've seen several individual coralites, or animals, of solitary coral. But this is the first colonial coral, so we have a colony of many different polyps, or coralites, occupying this fragment. These types of corals, these are called hermatypic corals. These corals had little symbiotic algae embedded in their soft tissues. And we know the water was shallow where this was buried, simply because these algae need sunlight. The water has to be clear.
A lot of these types of little tiny fossils evolved very quickly too. So their changes make it very easy as a means of a kind of a clock. This is really incredible right here. If you notice over there, there are different layers. They're about a foot thick or so. And we see one on top of the other, almost pretty close to perfectly the same thickness. You see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. There's clearly some kind of a clock going on. It's a tick-tock, tick-tock. And we see this in rocks everywhere, generally sedimentary rocks. But you can actually see them on other planets too. And they're due to the same thing. There are lots of different cycles. One of the cycles we have are monthly cycles of tides. Tides move up and move down. Those are very quick kind of cycles, only last a month. There are also some cycles in Earth's orbit. Earth is actually tilted a little bit off of the orbital plane. So it's actually, now it's tilted about 23.5 degrees off of its orbital plane. So as it goes around the sun, it does this kind of a motion. Always pointing to, and today it's pointing to the North Star. Now, there also is another cycle, several other cycles going on at the same time. One is that it doesn't actually point to the North Star continuously. In fact, it kind of wobbles. It's sort of like a top that's slowing down. So sometimes it's more close to vertical, and in those times there's not much of a difference in seasons, for example. Other times it's tilted farther away and the seasons are accented. There's also, that cycle, I should say, is at 20,000 years. So it does this thing once around every 20,000 years. There's also a cycle of how much it tilts. So sometimes, I'm going to exaggerate a lot, sometimes it tilts a lot, and sometimes the tilt is not very much. And it goes on that cycle about every 40,000 years. And then the other cycle is actually the shape of its orbit around the sun. In some time intervals, it's close to a perfect circle. It's not quite perfect, it is close. At other times, it becomes more elliptical. And those cycles are every 100,000 years. So you got these three different kinds of cycles, the orbital cycles, going on simultaneously. So every once in a while, they come together and form very large cycles. And if you look at certain kind of sediments, these are real obvious. They're exactly like a clock that's ticking, tick-tock, tick-tock. Here, I don't know exactly which one of these cycles these are. We do have a good idea, since this was a kind of a muddy area, probably accumulated fairly rapidly. So these may be 20,000-year cycles. That's a pretty awesome thing when you think about it, because these rocks here, these sediments, are roughly 32 million years old, 31 or so, 31 million years ago, and yet we can resolve time down to 20,000 years. This is one of the really neat things that we'll see on our trip. This is really, really good evidence of changes in sea level. We saw the lower part of this formation, and it's called the Forest Hill, when we were looking at the orbital cycles. It actually had a few pieces of marine fossils in it. So there was some kind of marine influence, but not as much as we'd seen below before then. So sea level was dropping. Now we see the upper part of the formation, and we've totally lost all of the marine fossils. And we also find bits and pieces of plant material. So we're completely out of the marine realm. So that suggests that sea level is continuing to shallow right here. And then about where James is up there, where he's pointing to, is what's called a sequence boundary. And that's the point when the sea level has changed from dropping to rising again. Because this is non-marine here, that material only about 2 feet above where James is pointing to is could be a beach, because it's got full of marine fossils. So clearly the sea had advanced. So here we have the old beach, and sitting on top of that, this is where these giant boulders came from, is a limestone. And limestone is always deposited in open, shallow, clear seas. So here we finally transition from the beach into open ocean right here. So geologists would come here from all over the world to try to figure out exactly what time that occurred. And so they look at the fossils and look at all kinds of evidence to date that and to see, and they go to different parts of the world and see, well, do we find this sequence boundary like that in other parts of the world? If they do, that suggests that it was actually a worldwide sea level changes there and not just something that happened in this area. So this is a very important section here to try to understand, also move from Wayne County all the way to the rest of the world.
James, we're at another stop here. This is a wonderful place to point out two really neat things. In this debris flow from up top here, we've got several different formations confused in the flow here. So we're not going to see anything in place. We're not going to see the simple layer cake stacking of these units. We're seeing them all flowing together, pieces of one and the other. In here, though, is a marker for a major event, a sea level rise. We've got these little pebbles, and we see accumulation of shells right on top of the clay mixed in with these pebbles. And then above that, we get the deposition of that marine shallow shelf limestone. There's really no more sediment input coming from the land nearby. There's a little bit of it, but we're seeing a lot of pure limestone, the remains of millions of skeletal organisms. And that's what we see right here, is the top of the limestone right here. And again, it's all confused. These things have flipped over. Coming out of this material, James found this fish head. This fossil right here is about 33, 34 million years old. It's probably the oldest squirrel fish we now have in the collection. And it was fortunate enough, though, that James saved it. It was about to tumble all the way into the river and lost forever.
As we look up higher on the bluff, you'll start to see that these limestone ledges are getting a little more resistant, and we're actually transitioning into what we call a high stand. This is the maximum flooded surface of the oceans. This is the purest of the purest of limestone that is sitting up on top of these ledges, and that's going to be the Glinted limestone. So as these seas came in, this is going to be the maximum flooding surface. This is going to be the deepest water that these oceans had to make this formation.
This stuff is really neat. You were at the last outcrop. This was made of the blocks that had fallen down.
Yep.
And that was because the rocks underneath there are really incompetent. There are those clay units. Matter of fact, where we were sinking down in that clay, and it just cannot hold much of a load. So those big blocks came falling down. Now we've gotten farther downstream, and that clay unit now is underground. So this is all that limestone unit beautifully preserved right here. And you notice also how it changes the character of the channel itself. We can see there's steep sides right here, almost vertical sides. As we go down the river, we'll see that also. And really, a lot of that has to do with what happened in the past, roughly 28 million years ago. Because the sea was relatively high here, there wasn't much mud that was coming in the system. And this material, this limestone, is made almost entirely of fossils or bits of fossils. And those fossils are made out of calcium carbonate, which is something you put in cement. So this is this material here is much harder, more cemented. And this is we call the Mariana Formation, Mariana Limestone. And this stuff is just full of those little tiny kinds of animals that were crawling around the seafloor at the time. During our trip, we've gone through about 7 million years of history of this area and have seen how the ancient changes in sea level are recorded here. These strata are very much like pages in the history book of what happened long ago. The history is not read in English, of course, but in the language of seashells, the types of sediment, the color, and other clues that must be interpreted and translated into a language that we can understand. Geologists always read the story of the strata from bottom to top, because that is the order in which they were deposited, one on top of another. But this is only part of a much larger story. As the Chickasawhay River winds its way to the Gulf of Mexico, it exposes many pages in the geological history book of the area and brings us back to oceans filled with sea creatures, both large and small, that are long vanished. It is a significant link from Mississippi to the rest of the world.